Man, and this is WMNF Tampa.
Support for WMNF comes from listeners like you and a community-supported Tampa theater, presenting the Holiday Classics movie series from Thanksgiving through New Year's on the theater's historic screen. More info at tampatheater.org.
Here comes the sun, I say, it's all right.
Hello and welcome to the Sustainable Living Show here on WMNF Tampa 88.5 FM, where every Monday at 11, we bring you a conversation with local experts on sustainable issues. Today's guest is Samuel Ronen, talking about helping building community after the storm. So stay locked into the left side of your dial. Irene is taking your calls, and the marvelous Mr. Bill Grace is working the boards like no one else does. Your host today is myself, Tanja Vidovic, and Miss Annie Ellis.
Hey, Tanja. Hey, y'all out there.
Before we get into our main program, Miss Kitty Wallace has a couple of events to tell you about and the events from the garden.
Not at the moment, she doesn't.
Oh, okay. Well, I have a couple of events I can talk about. I'd like to let everybody know that there at Sweetwater Organic Farm, December 1st from 12 to 2, there's a medicinal herb walk with Bob Lindy. And also this really cool thing, Pamela Lum of the Dancing Goat Farm, she has all of her bedding of her goat poop is available for pickup. So anybody can go over there. You just check it out. The place is at 12502 Maverick Court, Tampa, Florida, 33626.
We've done that before. We've shoveled a lot of goat poop.
Oh, yeah. It's really easy to do with a pitchfork, but you have to bring your own pitchfork, and you need to bring your own containers to put it in. And if you have a truck, of course, that's easier.
And it's not as gross as you think.
No, it
it's
really
not.
Isn't.
It's not as like wet as a lot of animal poop. And
yeah, there's a lot of them. Oh, that does sound gross.
It does sound gross.
But it is. There's a lot of bedding. You know, it's all straw bedding that was in there, and they pull it out, and it's good stuff. So, you know, I recommend y'all using it if you need it. If you're into organic gardening, it's a good thing to go with. So let's go ahead and welcome our guest today, Samuel Ronen. And he's a community organizer in Tampa Bay, and he shows up where help is needed for a variety of causes, from grassroots political campaigns to protests to mutual aid and hurricane relief. He is the co-founder of Florida for Change and the Progressive Jewish Coalition, while being active with the Democratic Socialists of America, the American Indian Movement, and the New Era Young Lords of Florida, and the Bay Area Dream Defenders. Sam's theory of change is rooted in the Jewish value of Tikkun Olam, a spiritual call to repair the world. Welcome to the show, Samuel.
Hey, hey, happy to be here.
Oh, yeah, we're happy to have you. And, you know, you're very involved in assisting and building community, but what made you decide to use your physical labor to help?
Sure. So I've been doing hurricane relief pretty much every time we've had a hurricane for the last decade or so with a great organization on the ground here called Mutual Aid Disaster Relief. And this was the first time that I became very conscious of the fact that people had, you know, more of a physical need, you know, more so than just needing aid, more so than just needing food, medicine, clothing, what have you. People had trees on their houses. People had trees blocking roads on their cars and really impacting quality of life. So it felt like there was an obvious need that we had to answer to get more physically involved.
Well, that's a great thing that you stepped up to do that. And you have a team to do that with?
Yes, I do. We have the Florida for Change Chainsaw Gang. it never stops being funny. But
that's so great.
We just kind of whipped it together. Mutual Aid Disaster Relief has a community tool shed operating out of Waters Ave Church that had a couple chainsaws. So I said, I guess I'll learn how chainsaws work really, really fast. And then the community answered in a really beautiful way and just kept getting us chainsaws. And now I know a shocking amount about chainsaws.
Yes. Well, that's good. I'm glad, because you want to keep all your fingers. So that's very handy to have all that knowledge. And, you know, do you use safety glasses on that as well?
Of course. Safety glasses, we have hard hats, we have gloves, we have everything we could possibly need because I really like my fingers.
Yes, yeah, I'm sure.
I'm very biased for my own fingers.
Yes, you want to keep those forever from day one to day whatever it is, the end days. So do you teach your people that are volunteering with you how to use these? Do you have like classes of safety classes and that sort of thing?
We're actually working on rolling out a more comprehensive lesson plan to try to make it a little bit easier to like get into this line of work. We definitely have a lot of people that are like, you know what, don't know how this works. So I'm going to go ahead and just move tree parts, you know, move debris. Like we have a lot of people that help with support. And that's okay. But I definitely would like to make it a little bit more accessible because, frankly, chainsaws, aside from some of the physical requirements, not all that hard to use.
Yeah, it really isn't that hard to use once people get over the fear factor and the noise of it. You know, I think that people are, they have a preconceived notion about the difficulty of it. So that's really cool that you figured that out and you're passing that on to others. So how do your people, how did you get these people to help you? I mean, where did they come from?
Sure. So I am blessed to be plugged in with so many great organizations. You listed out a lot of them. And everyone in those organizations is powerfully kind, empathetic, and already really tapped into the community and helping out on the community. So it was kind of as simple as going, hey, who here knows how to use a chainsaw? Who here thinks they could learn? Who here is willing to learn with me? And that took off immediately. We have about 25 members, give or take. And usually we send out 4 to 5 members at a time if we have an assignment.
That's wonderful. I mean, it sounds so very organized. Just the way you said it, we have 25, we send out 4 for the assignment. I mean, that's fantastic because I think a lot of times in these times of, you know, this trauma of all this, people tend to get a little scattered, but you bring some continuity to the table. That's great. Let me let everybody know that you're listening to the Sustainable Living Show coming to you live from the studios of 88.5 WMNF in Tampa. Today, we're talking with Samuel Ronen discussing how to build community after a devastation. What groups do you see helping with the cleanup? If you want to be part of this conversation, if you have a question for Samuel, give us a call at 813-239-9663. Text us at 813-433-0885 or send us an email at dj@wmnf.org and we will read it on the air.
So Samuel, you've been a part of these hurricane reliefs for the past, you know, a few years, and surprised to no one in Florida that Florida has had its share of damage, especially large damage this year from hurricanes. Do you think that this is the new normal, this level of damage?
Absolutely. I think especially since we experienced 3 hurricanes back to back to back that had more or less similar impacts on the community, especially in Pinellas County, I think it would be irresponsible for us to act like it's not the new normal.
And so what happens to a community when something like this level of devastation happens? What do you feel happens to the people that are involved?
I mean, I think the people, we rally, we take care of each other, but there are obviously some limits to that, and those are going to be built on our issues with infrastructure, with public transit, with sheltering. You know, a very big thing that I was concerned about with these recent rounds of storms was how often I saw public officials talking about demands that people evacuate without really a clear idea of how they would get there, where they would go. We didn't have enough shelters. We didn't have enough public transportation to get people to shelters. You know, if working people are working like 2-3 jobs and they have kids, they have family, they have all of these things going on, what if they don't have a car? You know, just so many little things that we're not even thinking about in terms of being prepared for hurricanes that are very much weighing on my mind.
Yeah. And well, especially if this is the new normal, and you brought up something interesting that, like, I mean, when I was trying to fight with my own community and about infrastructure, you brought it up. I mean, they I feel like the local administrations are so short-sighted by developing in flood zones. Do you think that these hurricanes are going to change their perspective in this sort of, in the realm of infrastructure and how prepared we need to be in taking care of people?
No, no. I think that...
Short answer, right.
But, you know, I think that the reason that it already is so bad is rooted in greed. And that greed is, that's a powerful thing. That's not going to go away. I think that what is shifting is how the community feels. I think that the community is understandably very angry. And I think that there's an opportunity to organize and demand that these people make the changes they need to be making. But I don't think they're going to necessarily make them on their own.
Yeah, and holding these representatives responsible, because it's very easy to show up and be like, oh my God, this is a horrible thing that's happened, when it's reality, mostly their fault for not preparing when it was their duty to do it. Oh, yeah. Do you see large organizations leading the grand effort of cleanup, or is it mostly like private groups and private citizens?
I guess define large organization for me.
Oh, okay. I don't know, FEMA or like large corporations, like let's say Walmart gets out there and does like leads a 400 person cleanup or pays for a whole neighborhood. Or is it more local community groups coming together and saying we need to do this ourselves because people aren't, because like the larger groups aren't helping?
I mean, I still have a pretty significant backlog for the chainsaw gang. So it feels like it's just me out there. It feels like it's just us out there sometimes. Even just like driving around Tampa Bay, I was gone for work. I do some campaign politics for my day job, and I was gone. I came back after about 2 weeks, and there was still just debris everywhere I went. So I went, how is this on me? How is this a me thing?
Just
regular people.
Yeah. So you're listening to the Sustainable Living Show, coming to you live from the studios of 88.5 WMNF in Tampa. Today, we are talking with Samuel Ronen, discussing about how to help build community after a devastation. But we want to hear from you. What groups do you see helping with the cleanup? If you want to be a part of the conversation or have a question for Samuel, give us a call. 813-239-9663. Send us a text at 813-433-0885 or send me an email, dj@wmnf, and I'll read it on air.
Samuel, I wanted to go back to something that you said that really struck me, that I'd never even thought about it until you said it, was that people, when they tell them to evacuate, they have no means to get out. There's no provisions made to move these people, or is there?
So I know that some of the municipalities in Tampa Bay had some efforts to use our bus systems and such. I believe that there was a program with, I want to say, Lyft in Tampa. Don't quote me on that. But in general, you know, it's just one of those things that I feel like people don't really think about a lot, is that we have such issues with our public transit system. We are so much a car-based city. So when you're asking people that may not have cars, working cars, to go somewhere, I mean, A, you have to have a place for them to go to, and that was an issue. And B, they have to have the means. You know, our bus system can really only handle so much. And that's to say nothing of hearts, that is to say nothing of the people that run those systems. They are doing their best. Mm-hmm. Shout out to public transit. But they are horrifically underfunded. They don't have what they need. And one of the things that we don't talk about a lot when we talk about the need for more public transit in our community is the fact that, you know, in the event of an emergency, that's how people could best get around. That's how a lot of people get around really, really quickly.
Yes, because then it's a larger group of people that could be moved at one time.
Absolutely. So
it just had not even occurred to me, because I have a car, you know, and selfishly, I guess I think of myself in that matter. I don't really come into that much contact, and it's a beautiful thing that you're just even bringing it up. It seems to me that people would, you know, want to bring that forth to our government, that the obvious, they can see the obvious information, and then that can be moved forward. Is that something that you do? You know, you obviously are seeing this and it's very clear. Does that go to somebody else?
Well, you know, there are great activists in the community that are constantly bringing this up to, say, the Tampa City Council or the St. Pete City Council, and are doing the good work, but there's always need for more. And like I said, I think that this recent event, these two recent events, were very galvanizing for a lot of folks, especially in Pinellas County, for instance. So I think that there's a lot of potential to organize communities around this issue and maybe finally get closer to what we need.
I do want to interject for a second, Anni, because you brought up like that you have a car, so you didn't think of it. But there was a lot of people who either couldn't get gas or ran out of gas.
Right.
And and with hours and hours and hours of sitting in traffic. So even people who have cars, you still have to think about it, because the roads, you know, I mean, they get crowded. And if you run out of gas, and if there's no gas, like my sister wanted to leave.
And she couldn't get
gas.
There
was no gas.
Wow.
I mean, so it's something to think about, but with increasing public transit, there's less cars on the road,
sure.
There's more gas available. So you all are bringing up
really valid points.
Yes, I mean, absolutely.
You know, because then you can get the people to the bus stop would be a thing too. I was thinking about that. And then you'd have, you know, okay, we're going to leave at this time. We'll be able to gather at this time, leave at this time. It's not just like a regular bus stop. And then, you know, to get that information out to the people in the areas, too, that's quite a challenge. You're bringing up a lot of things, Samuel.
That's what I'm here for.
You are doing it, too. This is great. It just seems like all this should just be a checklist to send to these folks that can make these differences, you know.
Yes.
So I noticed that I've been in a lot of hurricanes and stuff, and I noticed that people tend to put a lot of political things aside, put a lot of whatever their hangups are aside, and start helping each other. Did you find that as well?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I mean, the thing is, like, politically, like ideology doesn't care about a tree on your roof, you know? It doesn't care about a tree in your street. People have needs. People are in our community. And as far as I'm concerned, that's where it begins and ends. You know, we have to take care of each other. And frankly, I can't think of anything that would be more powerful politically than to show up at someone's door and say, hey, I'm so-and-so from so-and-so organization, and I'm here to get a tree off your house.
Yeah, that does make a lot of sense. I mean, it shows that people are people and are compassionate and not just one dimensional.
Yeah, you know? Absolutely.
I think we get stuck in that one dimension a lot. So what have you been doing to work to get your community back to what it was? I mean, how far are we from that?
You know, we've done a lot of really good work. And like I mentioned earlier, Mutual Aid Disaster Relief has been doing incredible work. They've been running free stores out of Waters App Church. And I know the people over at the United Unitarian Universalist Church, I always get it wrong, I'm very used to saying UU St. Pete. They've been doing incredible mutual aid work with a group called Aggressive People's Action over in Pinellas. You know, they've been really the ones that are, I mean, we're getting trees off of people's roofs, but they're the ones that are making sure people have medicine, people have food, people have clothing, people really have the things that, you know, frankly, make them human again and bring life back just a little bit more. So I think that their work is really more important than what we're doing. We're kind of just removing the barriers so that they can do what they're doing, if that makes sense.
Yes, that's a beautiful way to say it, actually. And, you know, when you're talking about that, I was thinking, yeah, I mean, some of these people are coming away with the clothes on their back. And, you know, and they don't have blankets, they don't have bedding, they don't have anything. So, but, you know, what happens, I mean, how do you find those people in need, first off? And then, you know, they've lost so much. How do you get to them? You know, how do these people get to you, I guess, is really, or to the organizations that you're talking about? How do they even know about this?
No, that's actually a great question. I feel like there's a question that always pops up in organizing is, you know, I'll give you an example. Years ago, I tried doing a free brake light clinic, which was a great idea that we did not think through. Because we did it, and then no one really came. And I went, Well, duh. We didn't really tell people. Who's on Instagram, you know? And I feel like that's often a trap that organizers kind of fall into. But, you know, the nice thing is that so many of the organizers that I am privileged to know and work with are already ingrained in the communities that they've been actively serving. You know, you think about organizations like Food Not Bombs and have an active, ongoing relationship with, you know, marginalized people in our community. They are already there. They're already talking. They're already assessing need. Some organizations like I mentioned earlier, Progressive People's Action, were straight up just driving around the beaches in Pinellas County after the last two storms and assessing, pulling over. Hey, do you need help? What do you need? And just making sure that we're active on as many branches of social media as we possibly can be, and making it clear, like, hey, no, if you need help, if you know someone who needs help, please send them our way.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's, I guess, you know, it's that Coconut Express, right? You, one voice tells another voice, tells another voice, tells another voice. So, you know, it is a lot, but I guess, you know, when you need a lot, you start looking, you know, so that's great. That's super great. You're listening to the Sustainable Living Show, coming to you live from the studios of 88.5 WMNF in Tampa. Today, we're talking with Samuel Ronen, discussing how to build community after a devastation. What groups do you see helping with the cleanup? If you want to be part of this conversation or have a question for Samuel, please give us a call at 813-239-9663. Text us at 813-433-0885 or send us an email at dj@wmnf.org and we will read it on the air.
So Samuel, you mentioned tree cleanup. Is that mostly completed, or are you still actively having to work on this sort of debris cleanup?
Oh, we still have cases. We actually have not even gotten to any of our Pasco cases yet. We have been so consumed with Hillsborough and Pinellas County. It took us about a month to start making our way over to Pinellas County because we have so much need throughout Hillsborough.
Wow. And so you say medicine, food, clothing. Are those things that you see that people have lost and they currently still need, or are a lot of those needs met?
You know, it kind of depends on what community we're looking at. I think that one of the interesting things about the last two storms is the fact that it hit in such a, trying to think of the right word here, an equitable way. Where people across all class lines kind of equally got screwed over by the storms. So there really was a need for everyone to have access to everything. Now, there is always a need for a significant portion of our populace to have food, to have medicine, to have clothing that just kind of never gets access to it. So the need really is ongoing. It's always going to be ongoing, which is why the work that they do is so powerful.
Yeah. And so I want to know, so you mentioned you have like 25 people helping you. How did you find them? How did they find you?
Sure. So I'll give one example. A very good friend, Shanti, who's a member of the Tampa Democratic Socialists of America. Shanti is a good friend of mine, a comrade, and just someone that is always around, always willing to say, hey, what can I do to help? You know, that's really, I think, kind of what it comes down to. A lot of these people are people that texted me and said, how can I help? You're plugged in. What do I do? Where do I go? And it really was that simple.
That's
and,
important. You know, that
some of them are organizers and activists, and they're in organizations like DSA or like the Young Lords or like AIM. But then some of them are Ryan, who owns Jug and Bottle here in Seminole Heights, who just kind of said, hey, do-gooder, plug me in. Where do I go? And, you know, he helped me get several oak trees off of people's homes and, you know, drastically improve lives.
Well, that's, and it sounds like because you spend so much time organizing in your community that you kind of set yourself up to be an asset when this sort of destruction strikes. That's really, that feels so important. Mm-hmm. And so is that primarily your chainsaw gang? Is that what you're working on mostly? Is currently still chainsawing?
Say that five times fast.
I can't even say it one time slow.
I can barely say it. It is one of many things I'm doing. I'm trying to juggle a lot. I mean, obviously, with the outcome of the election, there's plenty of things on my mind and lots of work to be doing. But Chainsaw Gang is still active. So really, a lot of the work that we're doing around it is trying to make it more, borrow a word, sustainable. You know, the first week or two that we were doing it, it was a lot easier because the world kind of shut down for us, right? Mm-hmm. Everyone kind of had some time off from work and things like that. It was much easier to just kind of wake up whenever and go, hey, want to go grab a chainsaw and just go and chainsaw some stuff? But obviously, as demand rose and as we started increasing our numbers, we had to streamline things. So now we've kind of got a good system where we're only doing it on weekends. We have intake forms. We have a person who specifically does outreach. I've been having to delegate a lot. You know, the secret to organizing that I wish I had learned much younger than I actually did is how to give away responsibilities.
Yeah, that's important because when you find out, well, giving away responsibility, it helps because you can't do everything. Yeah. And then it also teaches other people responsibility and gets them involved in the community. I want to remind everybody that you're listening to the Sustainable Living Show, coming to you live from the studios of 88.5 WMNF in Tampa. Today, we are talking with Samuel Ronen about building community after devastation. But we want to hear from you. What groups do you see helping with the cleanup? If you want to be a part of the conversation or have a question for Samuel, give us a call at 813-239-9663. I did hear that we are having a little bit problem with the phone line, so you might be better off just sending an email to dj@wmnf.org, and I can just read the question for you.
Yeah, we just want to hear from you. That's for sure.
We just want
to hear. So any way you can get it, right? So I wanted to know, are you still looking for more volunteers to help? How would they get in touch with you?
Yeah, always. So the main way that we've been getting in touch with folks is on the Florida for Change Instagram, which is literally just at Florida for Change. Reach out, hit us up. We primarily use an app called Signal for messaging and kind of coordinating everything. And we've just added you into our group chat.
Now, for somebody who doesn't do Instagram, is there an alternate like phone number or email address for those who may have a lot of experience with chainsawing but doesn't social media?
Yeah, absolutely. That's Florida for Change and then PAC@gmail.com.
Okay, marvelous. Thank you.
Yeah, that's important. So many people don't just have them all. There's so many medias. It's really hard to keep up with how many there are.
Well, I understand. I'm on Instagram against my will. I've had to get good at Instagram against my will. I did not consent.
Well, you know, it is an instant thing. So, you know, that's the good thing about it. That's for sure. So what, you know, you're getting the whole community to work together is from what I'm gathering, not just, you know, people just going and doing and getting the job done per se. It feels to me that that's what your objective is, to get the whole community together. Is that correct? And how are you doing that?
I mean, sure. I would also say that I think that I'm more a part of a community.
Yes.
I do want to make sure that I'm definitely playing up the communal aspect of this because I am just one guy in an incredible ecosystem of organizers and activists that are doing all kinds of incredible work and, you know, some work that I couldn't even imagine doing because that's their skill set and not mine. But in general, I think that's the most important thing is that any time that we're helping, that we're building community and that we're building lasting relationships, you know, in mutual aid spaces, we always say mutual aid, not charity, right? Because I think charity can sometimes be very one-sided, very temporary. I'm giving you this thing right now. And mutual aid is more about building lasting bonds and trying to build new systems as opposed to the old systems, because we're watching those old systems, frankly, crumble and fail on, you know, not just the environment and disaster preparedness, but, you know, the economy, democracy on so many levels. And I think that answering all of the needs of the world right now, it does come down to just building better, stronger community and not being afraid to help people.
You know, it's interesting, too, what you were talking about. It's like, I think that a lot of people get stuck in the old of everything. You know, they're comfortable because that's what they knew. They don't want, people don't like change, a lot of people. And even though it's not working, they'll stick with it, you know, and they'll just stay in that system that's not working. So it's really such a great point that you're bringing up, that, you know, you're thinking ahead of how to fix it, so to speak, or how to modify it to be able to make it work in the future. Because obviously, you know, if we're not, we can't even say climate change, you know, in the offices in Florida, what's going to happen with that? So I love that you are now, you are the do-gooder. You know, when you said that your friend from the jug, like bottle and jug or whatever it was called, and he said, "Okay, do gooder, hook me up." So that's your term now, huh?
Right.
That's funny. Yeah. So I wanted to also ask you, I don't know if you're a gardener or if you know the differences in this, but maybe, you know, did you notice that trees or plants, did some do better in the storm? And, you know, should we, when we are replacing things, because we are going to need to replant, should we consider native trees, or what are your thoughts on that?
Ooh, so I am not quite the guy for that. I will say that the older oaks, including a lot of mine, just seem very resilient. Like, they were not going to come down. They got those deep roots. I saw a lot of cedars down.
Really? Like, that surprises
me. Yeah, with all those knots, you'd think they'd hold up.
Huh. Yeah. What about cypress? I always thought that cypress would do really well.
Yeah.
They seemed like they did okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. But, you know, younger trees in general seem like, I mean, younger is kind of relative, but, you know, the old trees were
400 years old.
Years, like, those trees seem to do much better.
Yeah, yeah. So all the people and all the organizations that you're hooking all these folks up with, do you think that those bonds are going to last for them? Is that what you found in the past, that when you ignite that fire in this new volunteer, that they stick with it?
Sometimes, you know, that's definitely one of the things that I'm trying to focus on, and making sure that folks that are plugged in aren't just plugged in on this one thing, but, you know, hey, now that you're here, what if you also care about this? What if you also care about this? One of the things I always like to say is that there's many lanes on the road to justice, and you can go into a couple of them. You should occupy, you know, two or three if you can. And I think that this is a good, accessible way to start.
Yeah, that's a beautiful phrase. Many lanes on the road to justice. So there's some, I'm sure, projects that you see that haven't been addressed. Could you share those with us?
Sure. So, I mean, there's obviously been so much work in the local community around housing justice. I think that's a major concern, especially with the hurricanes, that I feel like we're not talking about as much as we should be, is the fact that it displaced a lot of people in a community that's already struggling with where it's going to live. People are being priced out of their homes en masse here in Tampa Bay, and have been for several years. You know, we tried to get rent stabilization on the ballot. Unfortunately, the mayor shut that down, and then the governor shut it down. I think that there is a lot to be doing around that issue. And at this point, it's been years of organizing around it. Some of it is just going to take making sure that people are organized and making better demands of our leaders. Mm-hmm. On that issue, I definitely look to people in the community like Tatiana Morales or Dana Lazarus, who I know understand the minutiae and the nitty-gritty of housing policy much better than I do. They're available on all kinds of social media. I would follow those two.
What were their names again?
Tatiana Morales and Dana Lazarus.
Very good. Yeah. Well, thank you for that. You know, there's just so much. Once you've opened this little crack open, and now it's just flooding with all this information. It's wonderful. You're listening to the Sustainable Living Show, coming to you live from the studios of 88.5 WMNF in Tampa. Today, we're talking with Samuel Ronen. Ronen, discussing how to build a community after a devastation. What groups do you see helping with the cleanup? If you want to be part of this conversation or have a question for Samuel, give us a call if you can get through. We're having a little phone troubles. 813-239-9663. Text us at 813-433-0885. And we will definitely get an email at dj@wmnf.org, and we can read that on the air.
So it's more than just debris. I've seen a lot of people now dealing with mold issues.
Oh, yeah.
So, and that's something that that is obviously really scary for people who are living in there. But as far as like a cleanup goes, a lot of the times it's not safe for people to physically do it. Like, how do you see people addressing these mold issues that are happening?
How
are they addressing?
Sure. Yeah. So I know initially after the storms, Andy Oliver, the pastor over at Allendale Church in St.
He seems awesome.
He is awesome.
Yeah. Shout out to him because this is good work.
Oh, yeah. And he was very, very on the ball in terms of answering that issue specifically. I know he was getting like full on hazmat suits or whatever they are. Like, people were seriously suiting up, boots and everything, masks. Like real like gas masks, right?
Trying to make sure you're not with mold because those little small particulates can just manifest in your lungs. It's gross.
It does not go away.
Yeah. But Andy and a lot of the members of the community over there, including actual congregants over at Allendale Church, because they believe in liberation theology and they are out there doing the work. We're literally out there doing the work and clearing mold out and going through the muck. I believe they are still active, but obviously with all the things going on in life and life kind of coming back after the first 2 weeks after the hurricane, you know, we're all learning how to juggle the relief efforts with everything else we have to be doing.
You know, that's a good point where we're learning to juggle the relief efforts. You're in it, you're seeing the struggles. How are people emotionally holding up?
I feel like what's interesting is I keep hearing about hurricane trauma a lot, and we're kind of throwing it around as a joke, but I do think that a lot of folks around here have some genuine, you know, PTSD from this. This was a very stressful series of events that really impacted a lot of people's lives. And on top of everything else going on in the world right now, I feel like a lot of people are a little bit fried, so to speak.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, I can't, it's a lot. And especially like people like you are still trying to help.
Yeah.
Because keeping up that motivation after, I don't know, after however long is, I'm sure it's hard. So it's nice that you have such a large team that are still doing that. And so that brings up another question, because it's never ending. How, with so much left to do, how do we grasp all of the needs that still needs to be done when everybody is so tired? Like, how do you prepare and keep going?
Oh, that's a good one. So there's a piece of rabbinical wisdom that I fall back on a lot that I always butcher when I paraphrase, but it essentially says, you don't have to finish the work. You just can't abandon it.
Mm.
And that is very much, that's my motto, that's my mantra, that's kind of what motivates me. And I take it to mean that, you know, rest is revolutionary. We don't have to finish everything. It's not all on me. And I think that the way that we get past that is by having community, is by kind of breaking out of this individualist shell that, you know, I'm guilty of. When I was a younger organizer, I very much had that savior complex. I need to do it all myself. I need to do all these things, and I'm running from issue. I'm running to issue, and I'm running to issue. And I burned myself out. I didn't help anyone. I had to take some time off. And you know, that doesn't work for anyone. I've seen plenty of people fall into that. But the way forward is just by, you know, having an incredible community. Frankly, having a community where people just kind of message you and go, hey, what do I do? Plug me in, give me things to do. And then making sure to, you know, delegating tasks so that I'm as sustainable as I can be and the movement can be sustainable.
Absolutely. And we have two emails. I'm going to reread And then maybe Annie wants to read the emails.
Sure.
You're listening to Sustainable Living Show, coming to you live from the studios of 88.5 WMNF in Tampa. Today, we are talking with local community activist Samuel Ronen, discussing how to help build a community back after devastation. Do you have a question for us? Are you, the phones, everything's working? Give us a call at 813-239-9663. Text us at 813-433-0885 or send me an email. I'll read it on the air. DJ@WMNF.org.
Okay. Our email is from David Bryant. Hi, guys. Great job with the show today. I was curious, to what extent is mental health factored in from a public health perspective after such a major disaster as Helene and Milton? I think there's a lot of survivor's guilt from myself and my neighbors since we are were relatively unscathed in my Seminole Heights, Tampa neighborhood. Thanks again. That's a great question.
That is an incredible question because I'm actually also here in Seminole Heights and somehow on, I think, one of the only streets that truly, you know, my backyard flooded, but I took no real damage. So I feel that. I very much feel that. And I can't lie and say that there's maybe not like a little bit of that guilt fueling the work, you know, in a healthy way, I'd like to say. I was relatively privileged. So that also means that I'm one of the first people that was able to kind of go right into the field, go right to action. I think that's the right way to think about it.
Yeah, I agree.
Unscathed, then that just means that you're in a better position to move and kind of help people and assess needs in the community, you know, go do good.
Sure. You had a bed to sleep in, you know, you had a place where you could take a shower, your clothes were there. So, you know, you were able to do that, which is wonderful. And that you were able to, you know, look, like you said, look at it as a bouncing off point, you know. Yeah. And there's another email. It's from Bubba. I really worry about the service workers in the restaurant and hospitality business who lost their jobs due to the storm damage. How can we help these folks?
So, see, in terms of like lost jobs, lost weight, well, yeah, sorry, words. Words are hard.
Words are hard.
Yeah.
Forming them is just the worst.
As someone who's dyslexic, I feel that words are hard.
But you know, I fall back always on recommending mutual aid and supporting mutual aid efforts like mutual aid disaster relief and, you know, the free stores that they do, because a lot of people rely on those things. I think that making sure that people have their basic needs met is one of the most valuable things we'd be doing in the community.
Yeah, that's a good deal. So what, you know, in the future, what can we better do to prepare for this? Because I doubt very seriously it's not going to happen again. I'm suspect it's going to happen again. So what can we do to be prepared as individuals?
Sure. So I think that a great thing that more people could be thinking about is forming tenants unions. And making sure that we are talking to all of our neighbors and forming those little community relationships, you know, just on the most basic level, just going outside and knowing who lives next to you and what their needs are and making sure that they know what your needs are. And, you know, frankly, it's unfair to put on people, but, you know, that's a great way that you can then lead into having like emergency carpools. And making sure that you get a lot of people out of an area very, very quickly, because if the government won't do it, then we help us. We keep us safe.
Yeah.
You're right. Learning, like, if there's a neighbor in a wheelchair, what are their needs?
Right,
like,
exactly. What can you do to help them? Yeah. You know, it's interesting because, I mean, I've had keys to half my neighborhood, you know, because they trusted me if something happened, I would be able to be available. But I know that most people, they guess they move so often, they really don't even know their next door neighbor, you know. And I find that from these storms, it does push people out of their comfort zone and they actually do speak to people. You know, have you found that?
Yeah, absolutely. I think that, you know, in certain times, like, you have to, you know, there is a need. And I do believe this about people, too, is that when times get tough, people have empathy. People are inherently good. I challenge any organizer that disagrees with me on that. You know, why are we doing this if we don't think people are inherently good? But in times of like disaster, when we need each other, we rely on each other. That's how we got here in the first place as a species, you know?
Yeah, that's beautiful. Yeah, because it really does. It allows you to drop all, because it's so intense. You know, this thing that just happened is so intense that it allows you to drop all the pretense of all those other little things that kept you from it.
Oh, yeah.
Pretty amazing. So do you see more people that are new to volunteering wanting to help? Or and how do you think that changed in them to, you know, make that step forward?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I'd say at least half of the people in the Chainsaw Gang aren't super, super involved in like local organizing. And I think in terms of like the why is because of how immediate the need was, right? There's just something so galvanizing and so tactile, right, about having to address this concern right here. It's not something that's kind of nebulous, like, I don't know, dealing with, well, it's not so nebulous now, but dealing with like impending climate change or, you know, talking about some granular political stuff or the economy. You know, it's a hurricane. It's a tree on someone's house. It's here.
Yeah.
It's everywhere. It's down power lines in Florida Ave. You know, it's here right in front of you.
Yeah.
I think that makes it a lot more, you know, it makes it easier to get people activated. And then once they're activated, you know, if we're responsible organizers, those are new organizers now. Those are new activists. You know, those are people that we're going to call on for anything and everything. You're in the network.
I love that. New activists, like, yeah. You're in the network, like the Do Gooders Alliance.
That's their new name for the group,
the Do Gooders.
So
I think that's ultimately the mission. You know, if you're a good organizer, you kind of want to make yourself obsolete.
Exactly.
You know, my whole thing, especially now that I'm of a certain age, anytime I meet younger, like 20 somethings, like I'm all about mentorship. I am all about making myself completely obsolete. I want a new generation to do it better. I constantly want to make a bunch of new me's.
Their backs don't hurt yet.
That's what I was going to say.
Right.
Is the key to getting those young folk in there. That's for sure. Yeah. You can bring the knowledge and they can bring the back.
Mm-hmm. Their backs don't hurt. The knees are fine.
Although, that's right.
A weird amount of the kids, they all have back issues. And I'm like, guys, you're not even 30 yet. I need you to be doing your yoga now.
Yeah, seriously. Definitely.
Christians, you know, do what you need to do.
Little strength training for sure. Right. So what other projects are you working on that we should bring up today?
Oh, God, where to even start? I am an active member with, like I said, the Tampa Democratic Socialists of America. And a lot of the work that we're doing right now is getting ready for a huge tone shift here. But the threat of mass deportations. I mean, obviously, we kind of talked about migrant workers earlier in the show. Migrant workers are an important part of our community. They're an important part of our economy. And frankly, I think that all of us need to be ready to defend our community. And, you know, that might take a couple different forms. We're talking more in the legal sense, making sure that we are building funds for lawyers that are going to be able to contest certain cases in court, working with networks of immigration lawyers to really make sure that we are able to protect as many people as we possibly can. I think that's my big priority right now.
I feel like that could be a whole show in itself.
Totally.
Like when you're building community and all of a sudden those members of the community that are helping and a part of the community, these members.
Oh, they've been living here forever with their kids, going to school.
And then all of a sudden.
Paying taxes, you know, paying into a system that doesn't even necessarily come back to
Huge amount of money that's being paid in taxes that is no longer going to be there if everybody's gone. And who's going to be doing the menial labor
there are members of the society that do all aspects of every aspect of the society.
Well, yeah.
Who are we to say that they don't belong
that's
here? Like,
right.
It makes me so angry.
Yeah.
So you know what? Maybe we should have you on the show to talk about that.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah. I'm on for it. Yeah. We're going to get fired up about it too. So I wanted to also ask you, because you were talking about the funding, we can't really talk about
money
exactly like that. But if someone wanted to donate to your organization to be able to, you know, power the lawyers and that sort of thing, how would they do that?
By lawyers or chainsaws or whatever.
Yeah, like, whatever the thing
what
is.
Are these what are the organizations that are doing good? Like that people can help and join.
Yeah, where do they donate to the do-gooders?
Oh, wow. Well, I mean, there's so many different organizations. It kind of depends on what your interest is. You know, there's organizations like DSA, which I would say, you know, don't just donate, become a member. You can become a member for pretty much any amount of money. If you just go to DSA Join, if you just Google that, you'll find the website and be able to fill out everything you need. It's very, very easy, very, very quick. In terms of Florida for Change, that is fl4change.com. You'll be able to find our donation link very easily. And that can go to Chainsaw Gang and all kinds of mutual aid stuff that we're working on. Mutual aid disaster relief. I am blanking on the website right now. I apologize for that. But if you Google it, I guarantee it'll pop up and you can donate money to them. That is that's an international network too, a decentralized network of people on the ground throughout the country, throughout the world, that are just reacting and helping people pretty much anytime something comes up. You know, they were active here, they were active in Asheville. They go everywhere. They just go where the need is. You know, talk about the ultimate do-gooders. Those, I think, are some of the most important that you can help out. Like I mentioned earlier, Progressive People's Action, that unfortunately are predominantly active on Instagram. They're all in their early 20s, that's why. But they do incredible work.
Right. All these youngins. Sorry.
All the youngins, yeah, yeah. Thank God for them, because otherwise I wouldn't understand Instagram. Yeah, but they always need money. They always need support, donations. Obviously, like places like Allendale, UMC, places like UU, St. Pete. I mean, talk about church should always have that social role in the community. But those two really, really have stepped up. Waters Ave Church. I mean, these places are doing incredible work, and they need monetary support like nobody's business.
Yeah.
Yeah. And when you say UU, it's the universal. Oh my God.
Universal.
Right. Right. That's why we say UU. It is the Unitarian Universalist Church.
Okay.
That's Reverend Ben over there. We love Rev Ben.
No, absolutely. And they do, they really do good work. Well, thank you so much for doing all the work that you have been
so
doing.
So much. Thank you.
Obviously, you still need help. So if you have a chainsaw, if you have some chainsaw skills, there's still people with limbs and trees on their house that Samuel could use your help. So make sure to contact him if you have those skills and abilities. So thank you so much for joining us on the show, Samuel.
It was great, Samuel.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm always happy to talk.
Love that do-gooder attitude.
Yeah. And thank you, Irene, for taking the calls, Mr. Bill Grace for working the boards, and Grace Benke for our website updates. It does take a community to build a community. If you enjoy our show and you want to keep us on the air, please go to WMNF.org and use that donate button and direct your donation directly to the Sustainable Living Show. Follow our Facebook page on Sustainable Living WMNF to stay in the loop. And listen to our past shows. You just go to Listen on Demand on WMNF.org or on your podcast and a favorite provider. I'm Tanya Vidovic.
And I am Annie Ellis. Y'all stay tuned. Stay locked in to WMNF for the next hour to hear Community Speaks with Mabili. And also on our program next Monday, next week, we'll be talking with Tanner Johnson. And he's the young farmer who's now running what was Jim Kowaleski's Freedom Farm. It's now called Theo's Harvest, and he's doing a beautiful job. We can't wait to talk to him. Now, remember, too, sustainability is a delicate balance, but by working together, we can make a difference. And true change starts with the person that you see in the mirror. Let's talk again next week. You're listening to WMNF Tampa.
Here comes the sun, here comes the sun, I say it's all right.